In order to truly control and tune every aspect of our car audio system, we need a device called a digital signal processor. A digital signal processor, or DSP for short, is typically located in between our radio source unit and the amplifiers. Now, what if instead of the DSP device being between two other separate devices, we combine the DSP with an amplifier? Well, this is what AudioControl has done with their new D series of amplifiers. My name is Mark and I'm from the YouTube channel Car Audio Fabrication, and I'm here today on behalf of AudioControl to introduce you to this D series line of amplifiers. Let's take a look at how to install this device and all of its many features. So here we have it, the AudioControl D-4.800. This is a 4-channel 800 watt amplifier with DSP built in. So here we have the box, and I know a first question that always comes to mind for a lot of people is how much power does this thing actually have? So 125 watts times 4 at 4 ohms and 200 watts times 4 at 2 ohms. And keep in mind that you can actually bridge the channel pairs for a total of 400 watts bridged at 4 ohms. As I already mentioned, this has a full DSP built in. It's got channel summing, AccuBASS processing, MILC source clip detection, and of course, speaker level and preamp inputs. Now we could just talk about all the different features that this amplifier has, but I want to show you guys a real world situation. So we're going to act like we're actually installing this because we're going to be using the Car Audio Fabrication Integration Test Center. If you're not familiar with my test center, what I've done here is I have a factory head unit, I have a factory amplifier out of a vehicle, and this amplifier has a bunch of equalization already going on with all the different speakers within the factory system. So we're going to correct that so that it sounds good on our new system. And we're actually going to be hooking this up to a car battery. Everything is powered by a car battery. So basically we have a full car audio system outside of the vehicle. So to start our quick rundown of installation, one of the first things we would need to do in a vehicle is actually remove this cover plate. Now, some of you guys may have noticed right away that there's actually no dials on the top of this amplifier to adjust. That's because all of our settings are actually going to be done internally when we connect to this using a computer. More on that later. So we've made sure that our battery terminals are disconnected. Let's just pretend that we've mounted this securely in the vehicle. The next step is we're going to attach the 12 volt power source, the constant lead. This wire terminal here accepts 4-gauge wire. Next, we attach our ground. The third connection you need to make is a remote turn-on lead. In other words, something that's going to turn on with accessory power with the vehicle. But in this case, I'm not going to be attaching that. That's because I'm going to be using AudioControl's GTO, which stands for Great Turn-On Technology, which actually monitors the high-level inputs. So our speaker level inputs, it will monitor those, and when it sees a musical signal on those inputs, it knows to turn on the amplifier. If you were using the line level inputs, you would have to attach the remote in. Now, one more cool thing to note about that, if you are using the high level inputs in order to tell the amplifier to turn on, the remote in then becomes a remote out. So you could actually use this to then power on a separate amplifier. The next part of installation is sending an audio signal to this amplifier. So if we had an aftermarket head unit installed or something that gave us RCA line level outs, we could use these line level in connections in order to connect the amplifier. Now, if we're integrating into a factory system, it's more likely that we're going to be using speaker level inputs. In other words, we're going to connect the speaker wires out of the factory head unit or factory amplifier. We're going to connect those directly to this amplifier. Now, this amplifier solves a unique issue that we see a lot of times when we're integrating with a factory system. If you watch over here on the RTA, I'm currently playing pink noise on my factory audio system. And pink noise is a signal at all of the frequencies along the audio spectrum. So what we're gonna look at here is if I connect, this is actually the tweeter connection from the factory amplifier. And you can see what that means is we're only getting the high part of the signal. If we use this signal and we were trying to play a full range speaker, so something like a 6-inch speaker, we would only have the high frequencies on that speaker, so it wouldn't sound good. We wouldn't get any of the vocals or anything like that. If we look at the next channel on the factory audio system here, this is what is actually connected to the woofer within the vehicle. You can see here we have a pretty much full range signal up until the highs. The goal is we want to add this signal to this signal so that we have a completely full range signal. And we're able to do that within this amplifier. Once we get into the computer and we are actually tuning this thing, we can go more into detail on how we can actually sum the signal and send it out to these different speaker outputs. But for now, we're just going to make these line level connections. For a quick side note, there's actually 6 channels of high level input on this amplifier. I'm only going to be using 4. Next, I've connected my speaker wires to this connection. This is a 4-channel amplifier, so there's of course 4 channels of output. And I'm actually using 14-gauge speaker wire here. I had no problems putting that into this connector. I'm only gonna be using the 2 speakers just for this testing application though, so we can go ahead and plug those in as well. The final connections that we need to make are for the USB, which goes to our computer so we can actually program this thing, as well as the ACR3. The ACR3 is this optional adjustment knob that we can install into the front of the vehicle. And what this will allow us to do is we can actually pick between different presets on the amplifier once we get it tuned. We can also control what we want this dial to do. We can use it as a master volume control, or we could tell it to only operate on certain channels. So we could basically use this as a subwoofer volume control as well. We're not gonna connect these quite yet. So if you remember earlier, I mentioned the GTO Signal Sense technology. I've made sure that I've switched that switch over to the on position. That's actually the only switch that's on top of this device. Now watch what's going to happen. Right now, my factory head unit is currently off. Again, we do not have a remote in connected, but check this out. If we go ahead and turn on the radio, you can see our power lights turn on here. And if you can hear it, we now have audio. If I put this on the ground and if I put this on the remote out, since it's now a remote out, you can see that we have voltage out. So this is where things really start to get unique, because we can completely control the amplifier using our computer. So you can see we have a USB cable connected here, connected into the amplifier. In the meantime, I've also connected the ACR3. Let's dive on in here to the computer. So when we first log into the software here and we connect the piece of hardware, we're going to have to type in our PIN code. We can set this up later. By default, it's 1234. This allows us to lock out people if we want to prevent them from adjusting any of the settings. Now, since we're currently playing pink noise, you can see that on our front inputs, you can see that we have what looks to be like a full range signal. Again, over here, this is just our front inputs, which if you remember, that's what we connected channels 3 and 4 to. So you can see that we don't have some of the highs. And in fact, if we click here and look at our front high, we can see, okay, there's the rest of our highs. What's really unique here is we're actually monitoring that input signal to the amplifier. So what's nice about this is we can do some troubleshooting and see, hey, we don't have all of our highs. When we go over to the output view, we're going to want to sum the two together. That's coming up. Now, the first few things to notice here is that we can mute the input so that we're not necessarily using that input. That will help us for some troubleshooting if need be. We can also adjust the input sensitivity. We have some time alignment options here, and notice that we can also flip the phase of each of our left and right channels, as well as actually delaying the time. Now, as far as our RTA goes, this is something that we're going to have in both the input and output view screens. You can see that we can adjust how sensitive the RTA is, and we can also adjust the update speed. So right now I have it on fast. You could also do medium or slow, so you can more accurately see kind of what's occurring. I want to adjust my input gain here, and you can see I'm currently playing a 1 kHz test tone. I can adjust it up by clicking the arrows on the keyboard, and if we monitor the amplifier, you can see that we have the maximized outputs light come on right here. I'm gonna move on to the output view screen. And here we can actually control what's coming out of the amplifier. Now I want you to notice that we have 1, 2, 3, 4. So that's channels 1 and 2 on the speaker level outputs, 3 and 4 on the speaker level outputs. And you'll also notice that we have this line out button. The line output button is for these 2 RCAs here. We can actually connect RCA cables to these and send that signal to another amplifier. Why is that super unique and really cool that we can do that? Well, we can take essentially a quote unquote dumb amplifier that doesn't have the abilities to control all of its setting. We can actually send signal out of our DSP amplifier here from AudioControl, and we can actually control all the different things that I'm about to talk about. So let's switch on over to output channels 1 and 2 again. Now what we can do here, here's our output summing. So these are our different inputs. So there it's off. You can see that we don't have any highs. I'm gonna turn on the front high. And what that's doing is it's actually summing and bringing in that signal from our inputs that we connected earlier. Now here we can control our output level, and what that's good for is if you wanted to level match between the front and rear speakers, or if we are running active between the tweeter and the front speakers, we could do so there. So moving on here, this button allows us to enable the ACR3. If we wanted to use it for a volume control, we would enable it on both channels 1 and 2, as well as channels 3 and 4. If we wanted to use it for something like a subwoofer control, we would only turn it on for the channel that goes to the subwoofer. Now we could also set our output to mono. That's something you'd want to do if you're using a subwoofer in a bridged application. We can change the phase 180 degrees, and we can also link to output channels 3 and 4. As far as crossovers go, we have the ability to select between a 12 dB per octave or a 24 dB per octave on both the low and high pass crossovers. And you can see we can use this slider to adjust our crossover, or we can also key in an entry. Now, while I was making those adjustments, you may have noticed down here that we're actually seeing the output in this case. So before, when we were seeing the inputs of what was going on, we're now seeing what the amplifier is actually sending out. So as I adjust the crossovers, you can see that we're limiting the output frequencies. Now here, you could see our ability to once again time align. So if we measured that the left front speaker was a little bit closer, we would key in that entry. Let's say that it's 20 inches away. And if the right speaker is a little bit further, let's say it's 50 inches away, this way the amplifier is going to automatically adjust for the time alignment. It's going to delay this speaker that's closer to us to center up the speaker's image. Next up, we have AudioControl's AccuBASS technology, which is a patented technology that they've came up with. This basically allows us to compensate with the factory bass roll-off that occurs in a lot of factory head units. We set a threshold in order to tell the amplifier when it should actually start applying the AccuBASS, and then we can adjust the level, which is how much bass we actually bring back in to the circuit. If you find that you don't have any bass roll-off issues with your radio, you can just bypass this by clicking this button. For the final section of our output view screen, you can see that we have the ability to control a 30-band equalizer. Now, if you wanted to, you can make things a little bit more simple and change to 10-band, or you can switch to 14 band, which gives you a little bit more adjustability down in the lower frequency range. The goal here is to match a target response. Now keep in mind that flat isn't always the best response. Sometimes we like having a little bit more bass, and sometimes it might sound a little harsh, so we might want to roll off the high frequencies here. And you can see that we're able to completely adjust and tune this amplifier. Now what's cool is you can see that we have a couple of different things here. We have the draw EQ button. This allows us to just drag our cursor and we can control the EQ. Next up, we have a bypass button. When we click that, it allows us to temporarily bypass all the settings that we're controlling with our EQ. So here's my favorite button here. This is the auto EQ button. If we click that, we're gonna get a warning message. We wanna make sure that we double check each of these things. We'll hit yes. The program is automatically going to control the EQ. If we select yes, we want to accept the new settings. You can see what it's done is it's made an attempt to actually flatten out this signal. Now, the way the auto program is written, it won't make too drastic of changes, so sometimes you might need to run it once or twice, but you can see now we have a much more flat signal. So something to keep in mind though is that this is the electrical output signal. In other words, once you actually get into the vehicle, you would want to use something like an RTA microphone in order to do final tuning. If we switch over to dashboard view, dashboard view allows us to see both the input signal, it allows us to see our new corrected output signal, and we can also control our EQ within here. But this dashboard view kind of gives us everything that we need to use all in one place. This makes it a little bit easier to control everything. The only problem is each of these screens is a little bit smaller, so you might want to switch back to the actual input view or output view. Now finally, once we've done all of our tuning, we're of course going to want to save it to memory. So what we can do is if we click and hold on one of the memory numbers here, we can save that memory position by selecting yes. The final thing to note about the program is that we do have the ability to actually save this whole tune to our computer. That way we could open it later if we wanted to and send it back into the amplifier. So let's talk about using the ACR3. Right now I have this set up to actually be a volume control. The knob itself has a nice tactile feel. It actually clicks. The reason that those clicks are important is you can see we actually have two LEDs here. If I depress the knob in for about a second and then let go, it turns red. And while it's red, if I actually adjust the knob, I can select between the different presets. And each click is one preset up. So right now I'm on preset one, so what I'm gonna do, hold the knob in, I'm gonna turn it, and we'll go to preset two. And when I get to preset two, you'll see that the red LED will blink twice. Hold in, go over, one, two. So now I'm actually on preset two. Something that you cannot control to be differently between the different presets is the crossovers. The reason for that is actually pretty smart if you think about it. Your crossovers, if you were accidentally sending low range frequencies to something like a tweeter, you could obviously blow the tweeter really quickly. By forcing us to make the crossover settings the same for all presets, that makes it so that we won't accidentally blow something like a tweeter.
So there we have it, AudioControl's new D series of amplifiers. Now the amplifier reviewed in this video is a D-4.800, but there's also going to be a D-6.1200 available. Keep in mind, the fact that these amplifiers have a DSP built in eliminates the need for having another device in our install. This means less wiring and we have everything contained in a much smaller footprint. For more information about these amplifiers and where you can purchase them, be sure to check out the links down in the video description. On behalf of AudioControl, thank you for watching.